Would you be willing to risk imprisonment, torture, and even death to bring the best-selling book of all time to parts of the world where it's illegal to do so? Well, my next guest accepted that assignment. Patrick Bell and his team of smugglers delivered not only the Bible, but also food, clothing, and medicine into Romania and other Eastern European countries at a time when it was extremely dangerous. Patrick, welcome to 100 Huntley Street.
Thank you, Greg. It's good to be here.
So tell me a little bit about your faith journey, because that plays into the fact that you get this passion and this desire. I got to get Bibles into Eastern Europe. So tell me about how you came into relationship with Jesus.
Well, I grew up in a Christian home. My family had been Christians for generations before me, I think, and had served the Lord around the world. And I grew up in Peterborough in Canada. And there was a point where I just thought I wanted to do more for the Lord. And my friend had gone to smuggle Bibles. And I thought at the time, this was the craziest thing I've ever heard of. But as I started to support him financially and start to pray for him, my heart started turning as well to the persecuted church. And so I thought, why not? Why not try this for a couple of years and see how it goes? And we'll go from there. And totally changed my life.
So there's DNA in you from your family line.
Correct.
You know, to be in missions. But again, smuggling Bibles, you know, I mean, Jesus does tell us to count the cost, right?
Yeah.
So this was, you had to count the cost because you could get into some pretty big trouble if you're caught.
Yes, I could. You know, I had listened to a lot of the teachings of George Verwer from OM.
And oh, yeah.
It just really made me want to be more radical for Jesus. And yeah, there was a cost to face. Thankfully, we didn't have to pay the ultimate price at that point. So
you did some training in Chicago. You head over to Austria.
Yes.
And so tell me the process. How did so you get some training and now you actually have to go.
Right. Yeah, the first trip, I think I was into Czechoslovakia, and I actually describe it quite faithfully in one of the opening chapters of the book. You know, walking down the cobblestone streets in the fog, and you feel like you're being followed. But we just had this very strange, maybe naivete, or I'll call it faith, that God was watching out for us, and there's nothing that the enemy could do unless God let him do it. So we walked in this very strange confidence and faith, and that really helped us for every trip.
You know, there's something about, you know, somebody's following Jesus and they're willing to take some risks. And yeah, sometimes, yeah, we're a little bit naive because if we thought it through totally, we probably wouldn't do it. So now you start smuggling Bibles into Romania.
Correct.
And so what you're praying, like, okay, Lord, when the guards come upon us, as Brother Andrew with Open Doors would say, now close their eyes. Is that what you experienced?
It was exactly what we experienced. Now, of course, the methods by which we brought the Bibles in were a lot more sophisticated. But if you could imagine a team of border guards coming around a vehicle and searching it for 4 hours, they would take apart every screw they could find. There's one person just watching our eyes to see if we get nervous at certain points. And we would just literally stand there, you know, our arms crossed, just confident. It's like, you can't find a thing because God's not going to let you.
But the Bibles were there.
The Bibles were there.
How do you explain this?
Yeah, I wish I could tell you. I'm still, you know, there might be some countries in the world where they still use these kind of methods to bring Bibles in, and I don't want to spoil it for them.
No. So you get in, you start handing out the Bibles. What was the reaction of the people?
Well, they would often just cry with joy. I know sometimes we'd bring in medicine for a believer, and they'd say, thank you, but no Bibles? And they'd say, we only have one Bible for our whole church. Please bring us Bibles next time. And so it was just always joy that they would see them. And it depends how many we brought in. If we brought in 50 or 1,000 at a time, just to see their faces was amazing.
But Christianity played a big part in the revolution in Romania with the Ceausescu regime going down. And to see that, I mean, how did that encourage you? And again, world events. I remember when they were actually caught and executed, and then the floodgates really opened in that part of Eastern Europe.
Well, we were in Romania 2 or 3 days before the revolution, and it was very tense coming into the country. And then we went back to Austria for Christmas, and we saw the events on TV and the execution. And so we immediately planned to go back into Romania, and we were there within 2 days. and I actually went through the same border, and the same guard came out and welcomed us. And I said, wait a minute, you checked us for 4 hours just last week. He goes, I'm really sorry, I had to. The secret police were watching me. But they welcomed us in, and they put these big Red Cross stickers on our van, and they put us up in hotels, and yeah, but there's still gunfire going on in the streets, and there was blood on the carpet and bullet holes in the windows, and yeah, it was quite an adventure.
And I know we share a real passion for persecuted Christians in Romania, of course, to the Voice of the Martyrs with Richard Wurmbrand, who was imprisoned there for 14 years in solitary confinement. What has that done for you in terms of remembering believers, even today, that are suffering for the sake of the gospel?
Sometimes we forget that we have persecuted brothers and sisters around the world. I believe it's about 1 in 9 Christians are living under intense persecution. And I need to remind myself as well to pray for these brothers and sisters and do my best to support them.
So you write this book, and as I mentioned before, it sat there for 25 years. You called it In His Majesty's Secret Service. Why, Patrick, did it take so long to get it off the shelf and out there?
Well, I tried to get it published initially back 25, 30 years ago, and no one was interested at the time. And so then we moved on in life. My wife and I went to Japan and Kenya and around the world.
We had some kids, by the way.
Had some kids, and that... Yeah, that added the blessing to the family, but a lot of, you know, busyness. But it wasn't until last year in April, my wife says, you know, you've got this sitting on the shelf. Why don't you scan it in at least so you don't lose it? And then she found me a contest to enter with Word Alive Press, and I won that contest and got published. So I was actually asking the Lord, like, why now? And why not before? And I felt like He said so clearly to my spirit, I didn't need it back then.
And where can people get it?
Well, if they want an autograph copy, they could go to my website, patrickbooks.com, or they could ask in the Christian bookstore if it's there, or go on Amazon.
And if they don't have it there, get it there.
That's right.
All right. Well, thanks again, Patrick. You know, and maybe you're wrestling a little bit about, hey, work, you know, I got a kingdom assignment. I'm not sure what, you know, God maybe has called me to do. We got people that you can just talk to and maybe just lay it out there and say, you know, would you pray for me? Because, you know, maybe you had something stirring in your heart like Patrick did a number of years ago to go into Romania. It may not be Romania, it may not be smuggling Bibles, but there's an assignment that all of us have. So give us a call, 1-866-273-4444, or you can email us at prayer@crossroads.ca. We'll be right back.